mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
The views and opinions expressed in the following program do not necessarily reflect the policies and position of this network.
Hello, it's Wednesday, January 5 here in Manila. I'm Stanley Palisada giving you the head start for the day. Here are your headlines. Today's big stories. The World Health Organization warns the global spread of the Omicron variant could lead to the emergence of more dangerous COVID strains. Metro Manila now at critical risk as the number of COVID-19 cases in the Philippines rises to its highest in 2 months. And the Philippine Health Department denies a reported shortage of flu medicines amid a spike in demand. The World Health Organization sees more evidence the Omicron variant causes milder symptoms than previous COVID strains. Details in this report.
More evidence is emerging that the Omicron coronavirus variant causes milder symptoms, a World Health Organization official said on Tuesday. Evidence suggests that the variant affects the upper respiratory tract and that symptoms are less severe compared to previous variants. WHO incident manager Abdi Mahmoud explains.
We are seeing more and more studies pointing out that Omicron is infecting the upper part of the body. Unlike other ones, the lung, who has been causing severe pneumonia. It can be a good news, but we really require more studies to prove that.
Since the heavily mutated variant was first detected in November, WHO data shows it has spread quickly and emerged in at least 128 countries. But while case numbers have surged to all-time records, the hospitalization and death rates are often lower than at other phases in the pandemic.
We had a good number of studies coming up, proving again what we heard from South Africa, that the vaccine still protects you against hospitalization and severe disease and death. And that's what vaccines were designed. The challenge has not been the vaccine, but the vaccination and reaching those vulnerable populations.
However, Mahmoud also sounded a note of caution when relying on data just from South Africa, as it has a young population, among other factors. He also warned that Omicron's high transmissibility meant it would become dominant within weeks in many places, posing a threat to medical systems in countries where a high proportion of the population remains unvaccinated. Asked about whether an Omicron-specific vaccine was needed, Mahmoud said it was too early to say, but voiced doubts and stressed that the decision required global coordination.
But while the Omicron may be less severe than initially feared, a WHO official from Europe says soaring Omicron cases around the globe could increase the risk of a newer, more dangerous variant emerging. The United States sets another global record, reporting almost 1 million new COVID-19 cases on Monday. That's nearly double the country's peak of 505,000 set just a week ago. As the highly contagious Omicron variant shows no signs of slowing, the number of hospitalized COVID-19 patients has risen nearly 50% in the last week and now exceeds 100,000. Overall, the U.S. has seen a daily average of 486,000 cases over the last week, a rate that has doubled in 7 days and far outstrips that of any other country. Though it appears to cause less severe illness, health officials warn that the sheer volume of Omicron cases threatens to overwhelm hospitals, some of which are already struggling to handle a wave of COVID-19 patients. The COVID-19 trend in the Philippines now mirroring the Omicron-fueled surge in South Africa. As Rafael Bosano tells us, COVID cases in the country are now at their highest since November.
Before the Omicron-fueled surge happened in South Africa, they were only recording around 300 cases per day. But by mid-December, cases quickly soared. The Philippines is seeing a similar pattern.
Nagsimula din tayo, nasa 300 yung ating daily average. So nandun talaga yung possibility na sumabay tayo dun sa pace na nakita natin sa South Africa, assuming that it is really Omicron that is driving this transmission, which is very likely, no, na Omicron na talaga ito.
Right now, COVID-19 cases in the Philippines are spiking despite having a wide vaccination coverage and some people getting natural immunity after being infected in the recent surge of the Delta variant. Experts estimate daily cases may reach 40,000 as Omicron spreads. But Guido does not see this happening since testing has remained low and the public use the cheaper antigen test whose results are not included in the health department's daily tally.
Ang nakikita natin on the ground is hindi pa nakakasabay yung pagtaas ng testing dun sa pagtaas ng transmission. Ito rin ang isa sa mga rason kung bakit hindi pa actually fully nakaka-capture yung rate of transmission on the ground sa ating daily case numbers, no?
Based on DOH data last December 20, the country's positivity rate was 0.9%. That's one for every 100 testing positive for the disease. After 8 days, this figure surpassed the World Health Organization's benchmark of 5%, and it has steadily climbed since. On Tuesday, the DOH reported that based on January 2 data, the country's positivity rate was 1 in every 4 testing positive for COVID. Also on Tuesday, the health department recorded 5,434 new cases, bringing the total to 2,861,000. The number of active cases now at nearly 30,000, which is the highest since November last year. An infectious disease specialist says, data from other countries show that Omicron presents mild symptoms which affect a person's upper respiratory tract.
Local experience natin ngayon, which I think these are really Omicron variant dahil gabi ang taas talaga ng
spread.
Ng spread ngayon, no? Na mostly mild lang. The first 2 days talagang naramdaman nila yung pangangati ng lalamunan, sore throat, at saka yung ano, no, may iba, yung low-grade fever. Tapos sumihina siya on the 4th, 5th day.
Despite initial information saying that Omicron causes mild symptoms, the public is advised not to treat this variant of concern lightly.
Tayo po agad mag-isolate ng ating sarili. Tawagan po natin ang local government unit hotlines natin. They can go to your place to test you. Pero huwag niyo ipagpabukas. Dahil yun pong immediate isolation nyo could mean na mababawasan po ang ating mga kaso dun pa lang sa mga miyembro pa lang ng households nyo. Hindi nyo na po sila agad may infect.
Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
Health Secretary Francisco Duque III says the Philippines is now at high risk from COVID-19. This as the country experienced a 448% growth in infections in just 2 weeks. The surge being led by the National Capital Region, which Duque says is at critical risk for COVID transmission.
NCR, nasa kasalukuyang critical risk case, pinakamataas po na risk classification, na meron po 1,475% 2-week growth rate at 8.79 ADAR. Ang Region 4A ay kasalukuyang nasa high risk, habang ang Region 3 ay nasa moderate risk.
Despite the huge spike in infections, ABS-CBN News' data analytics head says this is still not reflective of the situation on the ground since testing has remained low.
Pero ang nakikita natin on the ground is hindi pa nakakasabay yung pagtaas ng testing dun sa pagtaas ng transmission. Ito rin ang isa sa mga rason kung bakit hindi pa actually fully nakakapture yung rate of transmission on the ground sa ating daily case numbers.
All mayors in the Philippine Capital Region have signed the Metro Manila Council resolution restricting the mobility of unvaccinated individuals. Marikina City Mayor Marcy Chodoro was the last mayor to put his signature. Benher Abalos, the chairman of the Metropolitan Manila Development Authority, earlier said at least one mayor did not sign the resolution under which the local chief executives agreed to enact their own local ordinances restricting the movement of those unvaccinated. Abalos stresses the resolution will only take effect as long as alert level 3 or a higher alert level is hoisted in the capital region.
The resolution shall be in force and effect while the COVID-19 alert level in the NCR is alert level 3 or higher and shall automatically be lifted once alert level 2 or lower is declared. Na lahat po ng mga alkalde through their local government units, their own respective councils, ay gagawa ng kanya-kanyang ordinance na uniform in nature. No? So ito po ay gagawin ng mga bawat city o municipal council ng bawat local government units in Metro Manila. Pero mabilis na lang po ito dahil may template na po kami.
More areas in the Philippines placed under COVID alert level 3. Bulacan, Cavite, and Rizal are now under the third highest alert level starting today due to a sharp increase in infections. Metro Manila earlier reverted to the stricter alert level following an alarming spike in cases. Under alert level 3, establishments like restaurants, cinemas, and personal care services are allowed to operate at 30% indoor capacity for fully vaccinated individuals. That figure rises to 50% for outdoor capacity. Social gatherings are limited to individuals from the same household, and travel restrictions may be imposed by local government units. The alert level 3 will last until January 15th. Two members of the President's Cabinet now in isolation after being exposed to COVID-19. Health Secretary Francisco Duque is under quarantine after a member of his staff tested positive last week. Duque will get tested today, but he says he has no symptoms of the respiratory disease. Defense Secretary Delfin Lorenzana is also in isolation after being exposed to infected members of his household. Also under quarantine, presidential aspirant Senator Panfilo Lacson. In a tweet, Lacson says he had sore throat, one of the symptoms of COVID. He adds many of his relatives and friends have tested positive and that he's just waiting for the results of his own test. Lacson has had 3 shots of Moderna's COVID-19 vaccine. The senator made no mention as to how this would affect his presidential campaign. Another presidential candidate, Vice President Leni Robredo, finished her quarantine period Tuesday after getting a negative confirmatory swab test result. Robredo, who also had a booster shot, says she had tonsillitis, high fever, and bad chills and couldn't eat for 3 days while in isolation. Her daughter, Tricia, has meanwhile recovered from a bout with COVID-19 and dengue. Several Metro Manila hospitals are struggling to cope with rising COVID-19 admissions as more of their medical staff contract the virus. Sandro Ochona tells us the healthcare workers may not have been infected while on duty.
Mike, not his real name, is a fitness enthusiast. His friends were caught off guard when Mike tested positive for COVID-19 after four of his friends joined him for an outreach project.
Yun ang prime suspect ko kasi syempre hindi maiwasang makamakakad pati kamay ko. Tapos close contact kasi bintana lang naman ang pagitan. Tapos sometimes pag nag-work ako, yung nagko-commute ako, so wala namang social distancing. And then, bukod doon, meron yung mga nagkukwentuhan, magamit ng phone. Nakalimutan na nila yung commandments ng as a commuter.
Mike is part of the sharp rise in the number of COVID cases in the country, which has alarmed both private and public hospitals. In Dr. Jose Rodriguez Memorial Hospital and Sanitarium, from 104 recorded cases Monday, they now have 250 admitted patients, 97 of which are healthcare workers.
97% community acquired. Ibig sabihin walang nahawa dito sa hospital sa labas ito. Nung nagkaroon kami ng history taking at saka contact tracing, karamihan ang commonality doon sa kanilang interview is nag-attend ng family reunions, parties, pumunta ng malls, pumunta ng beach resorts. Basta mayroon social gathering. 'Yun ang most common.
Failing to follow social distancing protocols is one of the reasons they are seeing for the rising cases. The Long Center of the Philippines also recorded a sharp rise in cases. From 2 to 3 cases a week ago, they now have 30 cases. Infected healthcare workers are usually those who came from vacation.
Yes. Like the general population, yung mga nagpahinga nung Pasko, yung mga nag-reunion, mga nag-karaoke, mga nag-kung ano-ano, merong mga nag-positive din po doon. Mga close contact po ng mga kasamahan sa bahay na nag-positive.
For now, they are ceasing outpatient services starting January 7 because of rising COVID-19 cases. The rising number of cases is also to blame for long wait at the emergency room of St. Luke's Quezon City, which has 152 suspected COVID cases. The hospital also insists its healthcare workers who are sick were not infected there.
Kasi pumapasok sila from a vacation eh. So ibig sabihin, hindi hospital acquired yung COVID nila.
An infectious disease expert suggests people should wear face shields again as an added protection against COVID. Zandro Ochona, ABS-CBN News.
A shortage of medicine for treating flu-like symptoms is feared in the Philippines. Health officials deny there is a supply problem, but on the ground, the situation seems otherwise. Bianca Dava has this report.
Out of stock. This was what many drugstores in Metro Manila were telling customers looking for branded paracetamol and other medicines to treat flu-like symptoms since Sunday. Some pharmacies admit they've even run out of generic drugs of their brand name counterparts.
This is the first time na sobrang taas ng demand talaga. Kasi during COVID season talaga, earlier 2021, iba yung gamot na ginagamit eh. And yung flu, more on vitamins na lang nire-recommend ng mga doctors. But now kasi, more on pang sakit talaga pang flu yung binibili ng tao, hindi yung mga antibiotics. Yung mga over-the-counter talaga yung nagkakaroon ng shortage ngayon.
Once supplies are replenished, this drugstore owner says he plans to limit the sale of certain medicines per customer.
Yung iba kasi ang nangyayari, bumibili sila ng marami. I don't know kung for personal use or they're just doing it for hoarding.
Pharmaceutical firm Unilab also cites extraordinary demand, which has caused some drugstores to run out of supplies. It, however, assured the public it is working to immediately replenish stockpiles. The Pharmaceutical and Healthcare Association of the Philippines insists there is no shortage of the medicine brands they carry. The group explained the high demand may be due to the spike in COVID-19 cases and the onset of the flu season.
Isang contributor din dito would probably be the Omicron scare. Tatakot yung tao of Omicron and they could be hoarding some of these medicines.
PHAP is advising the public to buy other brands of over-the-counter drugs which can also alleviate fever and flu symptoms.
Pwede naman na magtanong dun sa pharmacist kung ano yung pwedeng alternative na brand na pwede nilang ipalit pag nawala or naubusan ng stock dun sa gamot na or sa brand na kinasanayan.
The health department also gives its assurance that there is enough supply of medicines. The DOH is appealing to the public not to hoard these medicines and not to resort to panic buying. Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News.
A Filipina traveler who broke quarantine rules in the Philippines is charged by police with violating the country's public health law. Gwyneth Chua and her parents were among nine persons cited in the complaint. Authorities found Chua's father liable when he fetched her from the hotel where she was supposed to be quarantined at just hours after she checked in. She and her mother returned to the hotel 2 days later on Christmas Day. Chua later tested positive for COVID. She's suspected to have infected at least 15 others. Chua is currently isolating in a facility in Metro Manila. Philippine authorities are also investigating the case of another Filipino who was caught violating mandatory quarantine protocols. Interior Secretary Eduardo Año said the returning overseas Filipino arrived in Manila on December 22nd and was supposed to stay at Seda Residences in Makati for quarantine. But she never checked in at the hotel and went straight to her condominium. Seda Residences reported the incident to the Bureau of Quarantine and the Tourism Department.
No show siya dito sa no sa Seda at kiniklaim niya na meron siyang BOQ exemption for quarantine, which the BOQ denied. No? Masaklap dito, no? Nag-pinupost pa niya yung pinag-iayabang pa niya na ang kanyang quarantine ay isang araw lang. Yung mga nag-facilitate yan, kailangan ay maging liable. Kailangan natin gawin yan kasi hindi po pwede ka dito, lalo na with the threat of Omicron, hindi po pwede na may mga mag-i-skip ng ganyan. Kaya nga, nagpautos na rin tayo sa kapulisan na tulungan ang BOQ sa pag-conduct ng mga inspection, particularly surprise inspection, sa ating mga quarantine hotels.
Stiffer penalties await quarantine violators under a new bill filed by Senator Mig Zubiri. The measure amends the law on reporting of communicable diseases to include sanctions for persons skipping the mandatory quarantine as well as individuals or entities who aid such acts. It sets a fine of at least 500,000 pesos or imprisonment of up to 6 years. A bigger fine of 1 million pesos or a jail sentence of up to 12 years is given if another person contracts the disease from the quarantine violator, leading to that person's permanent incapacity or death. Meanwhile, President Rodrigo Duterte has ordered the deployment of policemen at quarantine hotels after at least two travelers allegedly violated quarantine rules.
So the police must have a complete authority to inquire how many or the health authorities or the itong tourism sila ang magbigay ng listahan doon sa police and even the hotels. They can provide the information all about everything who is placed under itong mga restricted movements. Two policemen assigned to itong hotels that are quarantined And they also have to keep their mindful of their duty to advise the person. At kung magpipilit, then have the power to arrest them. No doubt about it.
Duterte has also tasked the Justice Department and the National Bureau of Investigation to probe other possible quarantine protocol violations.
Mr. President, I have already discussed the matter with the NBI OIC chief this morning, and the DOJ has instructed the NBI to conduct a thorough investigation of these incidents, maybe starting all the way from the arrival area of in our international airports, all the way to the quarantine hotels, and even to the home quarantine.
More Metro Manila residents get their COVID jabs as restrictions loom for unvaccinated individuals in the region. Metro Manila officials also set up to ramp up in vaccinations for senior citizens. The details from Vivian Gulia.
The decision of Metro Manila mayors to restrict the mobility of unvaccinated individuals in the region triggers a mad rush to COVID vaccination sites. In Malabon City, the line of vaccinees has spilled outside a vaccination site Tuesday. A local official says they are ready to augment existing resources if needed. In Navota City, the COVID vaccination site in San Jose Academy saw more walk-ins. To accommodate unregistered persons, site manager Dr. Elmer Pangilinan says they had to request for additional doses. This inoculation site in the city of Manila had a similar experience, serving more than double the jabs allocated to them. Infectious disease specialist Dr. Edsel Salvana says, given the Omicron variant's extreme contagiousness, it's only a matter of time before people are exposed. But Salvana notes, vaccinated individuals are 10 to 20 times more likely to survive COVID-19 compared to the unvaccinated, and 3 to 5 times less likely to end up in the hospital.
Pag binabakuna po tayo, dalawa po yung target sa immune system. Unang-una, yung antibodies. Pangalawa, ito po yung tinatawag na T-cells. Parang kawal po ito ng katawan natin. At hinahanap po niya yung mga cells natin na may nagtatagong virus at pinapatay niya agad yon.
Senior citizens are among those most vulnerable to COVID. That is why Metro Manila LGUs are set to hold a region-wide vaccination drive on Thursday to focus on the inoculation of residents age 60 and above. The DOH-NCR says Metro Manila has remaining 52,000, or around 5% of the elderly population, unvaccinated against COVID, and over 763,000 due for booster shot. Medina says all eligible senior citizens will be accommodated in COVID vaccination sites in Metro Manila on Thursday, pre-registered or not. The DOH-NCR also plans to make available several COVID vaccine brands and jabbing sites to give seniors the opportunity to pick their preferred vaccine. Local governments also plan to bring vaccination efforts closer to the elderly by deploying mobile vaccination teams and opening temporary jabbing posts in villages with unvaxxed senior citizens. Of its 110 million population, the Philippines has breached the 50 million mark in the number of individuals fully vaccinated against COVID. Vivian Gulia, ABS-CBN News.
Vaccinated travelers from medium-risk countries can now enter Israel. As this report tells us, that state has reversed a ban imposed in response to the Omicron variant as it ramps up its second booster program.
Israel said on Monday that it will admit foreigners with presumed COVID-19 immunity from countries deemed medium risk from next week. The move, which partially reverses the ban imposed in late November, suggests Prime Minister Naftali Bennett's government sees waning value in sweeping travel curbs, which have wrecked winter tourism. The new rules come a day after Bennett announced that the country will offer medical staff and those over the age of 60 a fourth coronavirus vaccine. Concerned citizens like Sharon Geffen welcome the move as Israel faces a surge in Omicron infections.
As soon as we heard that Israel was allowing people 60 and above to get the fourth vaccine, we made appointments, myself and my husband, to get the vaccine because we're concerned. We know it's very, very contagious. I believe it's almost impossible to avoid contact with somebody who has the Omicron. And I think that this is the best way to avoid getting sick with COVID.
Israel only approved the use of a fourth dose of the Pfizer vaccine for the immune compromised and the elderly living in care homes last week. Over the past 10 days, daily infections have more than quadrupled, and COVID cases are predicted to reach record highs in the coming weeks. Bennett expects up to 50,000 could be infected daily. The rapid pace of infection has led to many Israelis waiting hours in line for coronavirus tests, although Omicron has not brought corresponding rises in mortality. Speaking in a televised address on Sunday, Bennett said the country was acting swiftly and decisively.
Israel will once again be pioneering the global vaccination effort. Omicron is not Delta. It's a different ballgame altogether. We must keep our eye on the ball, act swiftly and decisively if we want to continue engaging and working with an open country as much as possible throughout this pandemic.
Around 60% of the country's 9.4 million population are fully vaccinated, meaning they have either received three doses or have recently had their second.
COVID-19 cases in Australia soar as its system for testing buckles under the onslaught of the Omicron variant. Here's the full story.
Australia's COVID-19 cases soared to a pandemic record on Tuesday. The Omicron variant has ripped through most of the country. Hospitalizations have risen drastically, and a once formidable testing regime is buckling under lengthy wait times and stock shortages. Australia used a constant testing system for a year and a half, along with contact tracing and lockdowns to squash most outbreaks. But Tuesday's new infection numbers were up nearly a third from Monday's, which was also a record. Political leaders have pointed to a largely successful vaccination rollout and few deaths relative to new case numbers. But Prime Minister Scott Morrison's fiercest political competitor, opposition leader Anthony Albanese, says it's not good enough.
So you can't get a booster shot, even if you have an appointment. You can't get access to a PCR test because testing sites are closing and the queues go for 6 or 8 hours. You get told to get a rapid antigen test, but you can't find one. If you do find one, it's not affordable, and they won't do anything about price gouging. That's the record of this government.
Political leaders countrywide have been reshaping their messaging on COVID. After nearly 2 years of campaigning for widespread testing, authorities now ask asymptomatic people to bypass overburdened government-funded clinics and take their own rapid antigen tests. But that has brought a new pressure point, an explosion in sales of home testing kits. That's led to reports of stockpiling, empty shelves and inflated prices on the few kits which have not yet been sold. Morrison has ruled out subsidising the testing kits, citing a heightened role for personal responsibility, though the country's competition regulator plans to investigate complaints about allegations of price gouging. Despite the spike in infections fuelled by Omicron, dual dose vaccination levels of nearly 92% in people above 16 have helped Australia to keep the death rate lower than in previous virus outbreaks. Around 2.5 million Australians have also received booster shots so far. Regardless of the soaring numbers, the number of deaths in Australia are still lower than those seen in many developed countries.
We'll take a quick break. Still to come, the Philippine Po body quashes another petition against presidential frontrunner Bongbong Marcos. Head start, we'll be right back. Thank you.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods.
You're back on Head Start. The Supreme Court shortens this month's bar exams to 2 days. That's amid concerns over the effects of the Omicron COVID-19 variant and Typhoon Odette. The long-delayed exams will now be held on January 23 and 25 instead of the originally scheduled 4 days. The SC also reduced the coverage of the exams. From 8 subjects, the coverage is now down to just 4. Bar examinees are asked to begin self-quarantine by January 9th. The High Court says it decided to proceed with the exams despite the pandemic situation to meet the demand for new lawyers. A foul-mouthed tirade by Philippine senatorial aspirant Larry Gadon earns him his second suspension as a lawyer. The Philippine Supreme Court indefinitely suspended Gadon Tuesday, almost a month since the video went viral.
Hoy Raisa Robles, Anong pinagsasabi mo hindi nagbayad si BBM ng taxes? May certification yan galing sa BIR. Raisa Robles mag...
Gadon directed the expletives against journalist Raisa Robles in December. He was defending presidential aspirant Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. against Robles' tweet about Marcos' tax evasion cases. Gadon is running for the Senate in next year's polls, or this year's polls. His party, the Kilusang Bagong Lipunan, has Marcos as its standard bearer. Gadon gets an extended holiday break as the court says the suspension is in effect until lifted. He was also told to explain why he should not be disbarred. Gadon was previously suspended in 2019, also over his use of offensive language. The Philippine Election Commission dismisses another petition challenging the candidacy of presidential frontrunner Bongbong Marcos. The petition filed by Tiburcio Marcos alleged Marcos Jr. is an imposter and that the real son of the former dictator had died in 1975. COMELEC spokesman James Jimenez says the petition was dismissed before the new year, though a copy of the resolution has yet to be released. The poll body earlier junked a petition filed by independent presidential contender Danilo Lihay-Lihay for the cancellation of Marcos Jr.'s certificate of candidacy. Several other COC cancellation and disqualification cases remain pending in the COMELEC. An outlier, that's how the Philippine Commission on Elections sees the petition filed by the ruling PDP Laban Party to reopen the filing of candidacies and postpone the printing of ballots. COMELEC spokesperson James Jimenez says it is unusual to ask for an extension months after the deadline had lapsed. He also explained the consequences should the COMELEC Ang Bong approve the petition.
If you open it up now, you can expect that a whole bunch of other people are going to start filing again. And when they do that, then we're going to have to go through the entire process from day one, which means that you're setting back the clock effectively at least 3 months. And we're not even talking about the printing of the ballots yet, right? Again, it's ridiculous to assume that if this is done, only one party will take advantage of this. Everyone will take advantage of this.
An appeal from Bohol for construction supplies as it struggles to rebuild homes after Typhoon Odette's onslaught. Governor Arthur Yap says prices of materials are going up with supplies running out in the province.
Ang dami pong nasalanta na partial at saka ng totally damaged. So sabi ko sa National, si Simpondo, nasa inyo, bagong budget naman, unahan nyo na. Kayo nang bumili. Pag-distribute nyo dito, papipikapin na lang natin sa provincial government. Kaya wala rin eh. Bigyan ka man ng pera, walang supply, mahal pa.
Bohol was among the worst hit by Odette and is under a state of calamity. Monsoon rains have persisted in the province in the last 3 days. Governor Yap fears the lack of shelter there could lead to the spread of respiratory diseases. The Philippine Ports Authority says all ports affected by the onslaught of Typhoon Odette are now fully operational. The agency notes sea travel is yet to return to normal as some ships remain out of commission after being damaged by the storm. Meanwhile, the PPA assures the public the rising COVID-19 cases among its employees will not affect port operations. 45 PPA employees yielded positive results during a routine COVID-19 antigen testing.
Lahat po niyan, naka-isolate na po. Contact tracing na po tayo simula kahapon. At dahil nga po, yun pong close contact nila, ay in-isolate din po natin at minomonitor po natin. Recall na po tayo ng mga tauhan natin na ano po, no, mag-rumilyebo doon po sa mga responsibilidad na maiiwan po pansamantala nitong pong mga kasama nating nag-positive.
Trading at the Philippine Stock Exchange was canceled on Tuesday. PSE President Ramon Monzon says they encountered technical problems in the connection between trading systems used by brokers. Monzon says they are working to resolve the problem. Investors were caught off guard Tuesday morning as the exchange did not issue any advisory when trading did not open at 9:30 p.m. or a.m. as scheduled. The PSEI sank to 70.41 on Monday, its worst start to the year since 2016, as the Philippines deals with another COVID spike. Real estate investment trusts in the Philippines have recorded over 76 billion pesos in new capital. The finance department credits this to fixing flaws in the REITs regulatory framework nearly 2 years ago. The amount accounted for nearly $3.5 billion of the Philippines' gross domestic product during the third quarter of 2021. Now, data from the Securities and Exchange Commission showed Robinson's Land raised the biggest amount at over 21 billion pesos, followed by Mega World and Didi Meridian Park. Budget carrier Cebu Pacific canceled several flights after tighter COVID-19 restrictions were imposed in Metro Manila. Flight cancellations include those bound for Boracay, Cagayan de Oro, Cebu, Davao, Puerto Princesa, and Tacloban. The company said it's reviewing its network and manpower levels after the National Capital Region was placed under Alert Level 3 status. Affected passengers have been informed and they may rebook their flights or ask for a refund. They may manage their bookings through Cebu Pacific's website. Now, here are some economic data releases we're monitoring this Wednesday. The Philippine Statistics Authority will announce the country's December inflation rate. The Philippines' consumer price index slowed to a four-month low of 4.2% in November, thanks to lower food costs. But it's still above the government's 2.4% inflation target. Now, Japan will come out with its December consumer confidence figures. Japan's consumer confidence index stood at 39.2 in November, unchanged from the previous month. Still, it is the strongest reading since May 2019 as perceptions on income growth and employment improved amid easing COVID restrictions and soaring vaccinations. And Singapore will report its November retail trade data. Singapore's retail sales rose by 7.5% in October, the strongest pace of growth since June as consumption strengthened following the relaxation of movement curbs. News overseas, scientists raising the alarm as deforestation in Brazil's savanna climbed to a new high last year. The details in this report.
Scientists say one of the most biodiverse areas on Earth has seen a surge in deforestation. The Cerrado savanna spreads across several states in Brazil. And on Monday, experts raised alarm over its survival. It's often called an upside-down forest because of the plant's deep roots, which sink into the ground to help survive seasonal droughts and fires. Deforestation of native vegetation rose 8% in a year ending last July, according to Brazil's National Space Research Agency. That's roughly 10 times the size of New York City. Geographer Manuel Fiera says trees in the Cerrado are disappearing with exceptional speed.
In very few places around the world have we had such a fast and intense transformation in the last 3 or 4 decades.
The savanna is also a major carbon sink, and its destruction is a major source of Brazil's greenhouse gas emissions. Amazon Environmental Research Institute director Arne Elenka points the finger at Brazil's president Jair Bolsonaro, who has called for more farming in sensitive ecosystems.
Deforestation is the most naked and raw indicator of the terrible environmental policy of this government.
The president's office did not respond to a request for comment. Bolsonaro has previously defended his policies as a means to lift the interior of the country out of poverty and says Brazil has preserved far more of its territory than Europe or the U.S.
Hong Kong leader Carrie Lam denies criticism, press freedom in the city faces extinction. Lam insists nothing for her is more important than the rule of law. Now, last week, Hong Kong police raided the office of online media outlet Stand News, with two of its editors now charged with sedition. The raid prompted another online publication, Citizen News, to cease operations. Rights groups and some Western governments have claimed freedoms have eroded in Hong Kong, particularly since Beijing imposed a national security law in the city in 2020.
I certainly would strongly refute any allegation that this is related to the implementation of the national security law. If implementation of the national security law would undermine press freedom, then we will not be seeing any press freedom in the Western world. Journalists and media organizations like all of us have to respect and comply with the law. If they are fearful of not being able to comply with the law, then they have to make up their mind and take the necessary decisions.
In sports, Filipino Olympic pole vaulter E.J. Obiena, saddened but not surprised by the Philippine Athletics Track and Field Association, or PATAFA's, move to lodge a case against him and recommend his expulsion from the national team. The National Governing Body for Athletics made a decision after announcing the results of its probe into Obiena's alleged non-payment of coaching fees to Ukrainian national Vitaly Petrov, as well as his reported falsification of liquidation documents. Obiena says he is relieved to finally know what he is being charged with and hopeful he will have a fair day in court. He believes PATAFA has now made his intentions clear that they just want him out of the Philippine team. He thanks everyone who backed him in his feud with PATAFA chief Philip Wico and stressed he is competing for the flag and not for the PATAFA leadership. The Philippine Olympic Committee vows to continue support for pole vaulter E.J. Obiena despite PATAFA's decision to expel him from its training pool. The POC says it will still try to get Obiena to represent the Philippines at the Asian and SEA Games this year and at the 2024 Paris Olympics.
We, not as a POC president, as a congressman, ibang mga legislators, we gave budget to PSC. Teka, para gamitin mo yung sa atleta, sa sports development, etc. Now, if PSC will not, definitely POC will look for a private funding for him. And question lang naman doon yung training. The D-Day, the competition itself, madali nang ihanap yun. Ang question lang doon yung mahabang period ng training and qualifying, no? So, who will bankroll on that? The POC will look for that.
The POC earlier declared PATAFA President Philip Wico persona non grata for supposedly harassing Obiena. Before we go, ABS-CBN is calling for donations for Pantawid ng Pag-ibig campaign, where every 100 peso donation can feed a family in need during this COVID-19 pandemic. There are now more convenient ways to donate through our digital payment partners, Lazada and Shopee. Kindly prepare your mobile phone to donate via GCash. Just scan the QR code as seen on the screen. You can also donate through PayMaya and Cebuana Lulier. And finally, the following peso and dollar accounts remain open to receive your donations. Let's all contribute what we can. Together, our help can feed more Filipino families in need. Thank you for your generosity, Kafamilya. Bantay Bata 163 is ready to take reports on child abuse and other child-related concerns. You may also call hotline 163 to donate or inquire about the Pantawid ng Pag-ibig campaign. Bantay Bata Hotline 163 is open daily from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. to Smart, Globe, and Landline users. This is toll-free for Globe and Landline users. Just dial #163 for Globe and 163 for Smart and Landline. And that's the Head Start today. I'm Stanley Palisada. Thank you for watching. Stay informed. Stay with ANC. Thank you.
mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.